So in most of our discussion so far, we have restricted ourselves to being on the processor chip. Okay, now we'll take our first excursions out of this processor chip. So if you look at a motherboard, you know, you have your processor socket, which is, you know, the most prominent device on your motherboard. Sitting next to it is a fan to try and cool it down. Okay, and until now we've talked about the kinds of cores that you would put on this processor chip. We've talked about in-order and out-of-order cores. We've also talked about using a large, you know, last level cache and L1 cache, L2 cache, and so on. And then ultimately, if you don't find your data in your cache, then you have to go to your main memory. So now you go off chip to access your main memory. Okay, so there is a memory channel that comes out of your processor socket, and then you have these memory slots on your motherboard. Into each of these slots, you would plug in what is called a DIMM. Okay, so a DIMM is a printed circuit board, and what it has is a bunch of memory chips on it. Okay, so each one of these is a memory chip. Okay, and you have memory chips both in the front and on the back side. The term DIMM expands to dual inline memory module. And the dual refers to the fact that you have memory chips both on the front and the back of this DIMM. Okay, so you know, one of these DIMMs will plug into one of these memory slots. Over time, if you feel that your applications need more memory, then you would take out this memory DIMM and you would put in a new DIMM that has higher capacity. Okay, so you know, we'll take a closer look at how these memory devices are organized and what control the memory controller on the chip exercises over these memory chips. Okay, I should also mention that these memory chips are made with DRAM technology. Okay, so you know, what exactly is DRAM? So when you look at your caches, so you know, this cache over here is implemented with what is called SRAM technology. Okay, so this is static random access memory. Okay, so each cell, or you know, each bit of data that you store in an SRAM cache is implemented with a cell that looks like this. So it's basically, you know, two inverters that are connected back to back. Okay, so if you have a zero stored over here, the zero showing up here gets inverted to a one, so one shows up here, gets inverted to a zero. Okay, so you have this feedback loop which ensures that, you know, once I store a zero, so if this is the value that is being read out, it's currently a zero. So once I store a zero, that value is always going to remain at zero because you have this feedback loop that ensures that the value never deviates from being zero, okay, until you program it again. So, you know, one such SRAM cell requires 6 transistors to implement. Okay, so it's not very dense, but it has very low access times, and that's why it is perfect for implementing a cache. But once you go off chip, you know, once you go to one of these DIMMs over here, your latency is already going to be high, right? Because you've already gone through L1, L2, L3, you have to go on these off-chip links which are slower. And so, you know, latency is not as important. What really matters now is cost and capacity, right? You're trying to make sure that your system has as much memory as possible for as little cost as possible. Okay, so now when you go to these chips, they have to be implemented with a cell technology that is more dense than SRAM. Okay, so that's why we moved to DRAM, which is known to have a density that is, you know, eight times that of SRAM. Okay, so how exactly are these DRAM cells implemented? So one DRAM cell is basically a single capacitor, which is then connected to ground over here. Okay, so if you don't store any charge on this, then it stores a zero. If you put charge on this capacitor, then it represents a one. Okay, and you know, then you have an access transistor which allows you to read whatever is on this capacitor. Okay, so a DRAM cell is implemented with, you know, one capacitor and one access transistor. And this is why it has a much higher density than an SRAM cell. Okay, now the problem with DRAM is, you know, once I put in a charge over here, once I put in a charge which represents one, over time that charge is going to leak away. Okay, so over time that one is going to become a zero. Okay, so you know, since we can't afford to have values changing, these DRAM cells require a refresh process. So, you know, every few milliseconds, I have to go in and read the value on this DRAM cell. And if it's a one, then I have to write a one again. So I have to kind of restore the charge that I had initially placed in that capacitor. Okay, so because of this refresh process, this is called, you know, dynamic random access memory, because the charge doesn't stay there and you have to constantly be reading and refreshing these cells. Okay, so you know, since this is a DRAM intro, I have to start by explaining what exactly I mean by DRAM. Okay, so you know, from now onwards, we won't pay close attention to exactly how the cells are implemented. What you did have to know is that, you know, these are highly dense cells, which allows each DRAM chip to have extremely high capacity. Okay, so that's kind of what I explained on this slide over here. So now let's go in and, you know, let's zero in on my processor and DIMM figure, and let's explain various terms, right? So as I said, the processor has a bunch of cores. It has, you know, L1, L2, L3 caches. Once you have a miss in your last level cache, you now realize that you have to access some external memory, right? So you produce the physical memory address, and that gets sent to the memory controller. Okay, so the memory controller has a queue for read requests and write requests. Let's just focus on reads for now. Okay, so there are all these pending requests that have to be read from the memory system. The memory controller will pick one of these out, and it will then send the request over the memory channel. Okay, so coming out of this processor socket are a bunch of pins, and these pins then connect to wires which are drawn on the motherboard. Okay, and that those wires are essentially your memory channel or memory bus. Okay, and the memory channel itself is broken up into a data bus and a separate address or command and control bus. Okay, so this data bus usually has a width of about 64 bits. Okay, and later we'll look at systems that also have error correction support, in which case this bus will have a width of 72 bits. Okay, but for now let's assume that this is a 64-bit bus. Then you have the address and command bus, which is, you know, typically 23 bits or in that neighborhood. And out of these 23 bits, there will be 17 bits of address and, let's say, you know, 6 bits of control or command signals. Okay, so this entire memory bus then shows up at one of these memory slots, and then you plug a DIMM into that memory slot. And what I'm showing in this example DIMM are 8 DRAM chips on the front and 8 DRAM chips on the back. Okay, so now let's look at how this bus will then be distributed to the different chips on this DIMM. Okay, so you have a 64-bit data bus that arrives in over here. So 64 bits of data. And we will assume that each one of these DRAM chips can provide an 8-bit output in a given cycle. Okay, so you know, this guy can provide 8 bits of data at a time. Okay, so this 64-bit bus is essentially being distributed across the many chips, right? So out of these 64 bits, 8 bits arrive over here. And then, you know, there are 8 more wires that go into this chip and so on, right? So everybody gets, you know, 8 bits of data. All right, and these 23 bits, this address command bus, gets sent to every single one of these DRAM chips. Okay, so it is broadcast across all of the chips on this DIMM because everyone needs to see what address is being accessed. And once you receive that address request, every DRAM chip is providing 8 bits of data to try and keep the 64-bit bus full. Okay, so you know, these 8 DRAM chips in this example constitute a single rank. Okay, so rank is a collection of DRAM chips that together can keep a 64-bit bus busy. Okay, so in this case, I used 8 DRAM chips where each one had an output width of 8 bits. Right, so this gives me 64 bits of data in every single transfer. I could have also used, you know, 16 DRAM chips where each one has a 4-bit output, and that would also give me my 64-bit output. I could have also used, you know, 4 DRAM chips where each one has a 16-bit data output. And so, you know, these are the number of DRAM chips, and this refers to the output width of each DRAM chip, you know, represented by this X16 notation, which is pronounced as by 16.